companies may be scripting a new story as they spread their wings to new markets, but the last few years have been tough. A protracted slowdown and uncertainty on what lies ahead has forced many companies to recalibrate their plans on the global stage. So how are things looking, and what are the biggest concerns for Indian CEOs who have global ambitions? We sat down with Dr. Nirmalya Kumar, Professor of Marketing at the London Business School, a man who advises some of the world's best-known companies, and many in India.
It's a very important time because companies are not really sure what to do, because a lot of what the outcomes of their strategy don't depend on them. It depends on the external environment. Mm-hmm. And the external environment is highly volatile, as you mentioned. There's a lot of economic growth potential problems that are coming, actually, in the sense that even though the growth has slowed down, we don't see any turn coming anytime soon, which means that we know that Europe is going to be in bigger crisis. America is very slow recovery starting. Some shoots we are seeing. India and China are slowing down because in the end, the export markets of India and China are still Europe and America for the most part. So there's a global slowdown of growth. There's also a lot of uncertainty. So the companies are saying, okay, let us grab growth where we can, and let us try to find ways to cut costs where we can. So this has meant that in the developed world, especially Europe and America, it's a game of cost cutting, getting the costs down, and some innovation to get customers to buy more, even though they are tight-fisted. In India and China, it's still a growth story. It's still about capturing the future growth. But it's not about putting in the kinds of investment we were putting in previously, because companies are a bit wary today compared to the past, because they know there's a growth slowdown coming and everybody doesn't want to expand capacity at the top of the cycle and then be stuck with a lot of capacity when the downturn comes. So that's the challenge.
You've always maintained that marketeers should be more aligned with the CEO. You've always spoken about why marketeers are not on boards of companies and they are seen as an adjunct rather than a core. Is this more a time when the two functions have to come together?
Well, I wouldn't say it's more of a time. The problem is that, you know, whenever there's a slowdown, the first thing that people think of cutting is marketing expenses, right? Because you don't see any immediate loss of share or sales because of that. Though over time, you're endangering your brand franchise. So the best CEOs know that we have to keep maintaining spending. And we did an interesting study with my co-author, J.B. Steenkamp, where we talked about what strategies work in recessions. And what we found was that the strategies that work in recession are counterintuitive to what managers believe. Because managers believe that in a time of recession, sales are going to be lower, let's cut our costs. Most important cost to be cut, advertising. Secondly, let's not introduce new products at this time, because if you introduce new products in a slowdown period, people may not want to buy. And thirdly, because volume is going to go down, let's increase prices so that we make up for the lost volume, right? And we found that the companies that actually gain shares versus the companies that lose share in a recession are companies, the companies that gain share increase advertising, did not slow down their new product introductions, and did not increase prices as much as the companies that lost share. And they also did not do as many promotions as the companies that lost share. So in some sense, whether it's recession or whether it's a growth period, you need to keep clear about your strategy. And your strategy is bring value to the customers, which is through introducing new products, advertising is benefits.
Okay. But at a time for slowdown of uncertainty, people's spends really reduce. So isn't it dangerous to play that game, to actually have new products come into a market when there is...
But because people's spend is reduced, you're right. So people are reluctant to spend money unless the product offers something really new. So if it's an existing product, then people start looking for cheaper alternatives. And the only way you can persuade people in hard times to pay any additional money is if they think that this thing has overwhelming value. And overwhelming value comes from newness, right? Bringing new benefits to the customer, which they've not had before. You see, so you find that, and also the kind of new products also make a difference. So for example, people are very tight-fisted right now because it's a slowdown period in the West. But they're willing to spend on luxury ice cream. Why? Because luxury ice cream is a small treat, which in some sense, you know, doesn't change the household budget. Right? But it makes people feel like even in a tough time, we can have spoil ourselves a little bit, right? So it's also very clever, you know, because in that kind of hard times, people still want to feel good about themselves. And maybe small things can make them feel good and you can introduce. So you see, specialty coffee is still doing well. Little ice cream, specialty ice creams are still doing well. That's the thing to remember. And the other thing to remember is that there are two markets in every market. And one market is not affected by this. Despite all the global slowdown, the 1% are doing very well. So all those products and services that are targeted to the top 1% of the population are doing extremely well. It's the consumer household packaged good companies, you know, which deal with the mass middle class that are really having a struggle, because for them is the mass middle. You know, if you're a luxury company, it doesn't matter.
You've studied the developed markets and the emerging markets, the emerging powerhouses, as you've called them. Let's look at India. What's driving India even now, despite the slowdown and despite the negativity, is the consumption story. Do you think that's robust? Do you think that is so multi-layered that it will only grow from here?
So Indian consumption is very robust. So Indian consumption will keep growing because we still have a lot of untapped consumption waiting from people who are trying to meet even the basic needs. The thing is that the easy growth, when it goes away, companies have to fight harder. So we are not, if we go from 9% growth to 6% growth, by the way, 6% growth, we would die for in Spain. In Spain, I would die for 0% growth, in fact, you know, or Greece or Italy or Portugal. Yeah. You see, even in England, 1-2% growth is great. In America, they would be elated with 3% growth. You see, so 6% growth is still a lot of growth, except that because people in India are so poor and we need to lift these poor people out of poverty, we need the high growth rates, because high growth rates is what's getting, you know, the next 100 million people out of poverty in the next 5 to 10 years, which is what is our objective as a country. You see, so the growth will continue, companies will still do well, but it won't be as easy as it was, let's say, in the last 10 years.
You know, I was talking to a lot of people about the Indian consumer, and the two things that stood out was, one, that they really like value for money as a concept, and the second, that they're quite fickle, because for the first time, they are exposed to so many brands, so many products, that they want to, they're still testing it out. So in a time like this, how should companies be looking at it?
So, I would say that Indian customer is value conscious. There's no doubt about it. But the Indian customer has proven time and time again that they're willing to pay for additional value. Value conscious does not mean I buy the cheapest. It means I'm willing to pay for additional value. So if you bring additional value, you see branded jewelry. Nobody thought branded jewelry would be so big in India. But people are willing to buy branded jewelry and pay some additional money beyond the cost of price of the gold. You know, when you talk to my mother, she said, what is the gold price? What is the price of this jewelry? But you see, that mentality and that link has been broken, because people are willing to pay for additional value. So value conscious just means that we have to work harder as marketers to convince the customer there is additional value in our products and services, and the price that we are asking as a premium for that additional value is not outrageous. And if you do that, the Indian customer has shown time and again that they're willing to pay for value.
The biggest companies in India have learned this the tough way. In fact, India is one of the toughest markets to work in, and Nirmalya Kumar believes that traditional theories may not work for marketeers here. So what does? Find out when we return.